السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الذي يجيبني حين أناديه ويستر علي كل عورة وأنا أعصيه ويعظم النعمة علي فلا أجازيه. نحمده ونسبحه ونقدسه على آلائه ونعمائه، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، إلها واحدا أحدا فردا صمدا قيوما، نؤمن له بالربوبية ونقر له بالعبودية. من يهدي الله فهو المهتدي، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. ونشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله، أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وترحم على محمد وآل محمد كأفضل ما صليت وسلمت وباركت وترحمت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. وصل اللهم وسلم على جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين والأوصياء والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وعترة نبيك الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين والصفوة من أصحابه المنتجبين ومن تبعهم بإحسان وإيمان إلى يوم الدين. عباد الله، أوصيكم وأوصي نفسي بتقوى الله ولزوم أمره. قال ربنا العزيز في كتابه الكريم، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: ولقد بوأنا بني إسرائيل مبوأ صدق ورزقناهم من الطيبات فما اختلفوا حتى جاءهم العلم إن ربك يقضي بينهم يوم القيامة فيما كانوا فيه يختلفون. صدق الله العلي العظيم.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
There are numerous passages in the Holy Quran, and this was one of them, Surah Yunus chapter 10 verse 93, the one I read earlier, that inform us that one of the reasons of strife and division among the communities is not ignorance, it is the knowledge. We tend to think that people who do not understand, those who don't read or write, those who have no knowledge, they tend to have division among themselves. The Quran is saying that it could be also the knowledge. It becomes ilm. Ilm and knowledge becomes the source of division too. Here you are. فَمَا اخْتَلَفُوا حَتَّى جَاءَهُمُ الْعِلْمُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, as an example, this is one example. One example in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bani Israel, we بَوَّأْنَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ مُبَوَّأَ صِدْقٍ. We provided them a dwelling which was honorable dwelling, مُبَوَّأَ صِدْقٍ. And we provided them from our provision, وَرَزَقْنَاهُمْ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ, what is lawful. فَمَا اخْتَلَفُوا, they did not disagree and fighting their prophets, their leaders. حَتَّى جَاءَهُمُ الْعِلْمِ, after they received the knowledge, they received the evidence, they knew what is right and what is wrong. After that, they started fighting against Musa alayhi salam. Not before that. So their fighting and their division was not out of ignorance. It was out of understanding. They knew what they were doing. They were well aware of what they were doing. Look at another verse in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran. كَيْفَ يَهْدِ اللَّهُ قَوْمًا كَفَرُوا بَعْدَ إِيمَانِهِمْ God is saying, how do you expect God to guide people after they were guided, they embraced the belief, they embraced the faith? كَفَرُوا بَعْدَ إِيمَانِهِمْ After embracing the faith, they disbelieved again. They disbelieved. وَشَهِدُوا أَنَّ الرَّسُولَ حَقٌّ Today we have an argument in the Muslim, within the Muslim Ummah. This argument says, someone who embraced faith, he would never be misguided again. Quran says this is wrong. This is wrong. This is the Quran right before you. كَيْفَ يَهْدِ اللَّهُ قَوْمًا كَفَرُوا بَعْدَ إِيمَانِهِمْ How do you expect God to have mercy on a community who accepted faith in the beginning, وَشَهِدُوا أَنَّ الرَّسُولَ حَقٍ They knew very well that this messenger is the messenger of truth, حق. وَجَاءَهُمُ الْبَيِّنَاتِ And they had the knowledge and the clear signs. Not that they did not receive them. If they did not receive them, God is not going to punish them. وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا We would never punish until we send a clear message. So they received a clear message and they prayed behind the Prophet and they said to him, you are truly the messenger of God. Yet they chose after a period of time to reject Islam. كَفَرُوا بَعْدَ إِيمَانِهِمْ Very plain. They rejected faith after they embraced it earlier. God says, how do you want me to forgive them? How do you expect me to forgive such people? I might forgive people who are unaware. But people who were fully aware of the truth and falsehood, and for a period of time they were on the side of the truth, and then they chose to change and to shift from truth to falsehood, how do you expect me to have mercy on them, or forgive them, or guide them? كَيْفَ يَهْدِ اللَّهُ قَوْمًا كَفَرُوا بَعْدَ إِيمَانِهِمْ So this is another example. A third example in the Quran, again in Surah Al-Imran. إِنَّ الدِّينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ Verily, the religion of God or with God, which is accepted by God, is Islam. Now there is a debate among the scholars nowadays whether this Islam with a capital I or a small I. Some people say capital I means Islam here means submission. Now, whether you are a Jew or a Christian or any religion you choose, as long as you submit to God, then you are Muslim. You are called Muslim. Another group says, no, Islam here means the last religion that was introduced by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the most updated version of religion introduced by the Prophet. Khatamul Anbiya. He is the seal of the messengers and his religion, Khatamul Adyan, the seal of religions. Inna ad-deen 'inda Allah al-Islam. This is another discussion. I don't want to delve into it now. Inna ad-deen, verily, religion with God is Islam. Wa ma ikhtalafa alladhina utul kitab. This is very interesting. The people of the book, they did not reject the Prophet out of ignorance. وَمَا اخْتَلَفَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَهُمُ الْعِلْمِ They were well aware that this is the messenger of God. He represents God. And his book is an authentic book. مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَهُمُ الْعِلْمِ They chose. Then let me ask you, why people after knowing the truth and falsehood, why still after knowing it, they choose to follow falsehood? What is the reason for that? If someone, they tell him, listen, this freeway takes you to happiness. If you take that freeway, you're going to end up in hell, in disaster. in jail, let's say. Why does he choose the other one, the wrong one? Why? What is the reason? Quran mentions the reason. Quran mentions the reason. Allah knows the reason better than us. Allah says, وَمَا اخْتَلَفَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَهُمُ الْعِلْمُ بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ بَغْيًا بَغْي conceit and jealousy and defiance to God. بَغْيًا aggression, an act of aggression. The soul does not want to listen to God. The soul wants to be by itself, wants to defy God. This is baghi. Baghi has many meanings. One of the meanings of baghi is dhulm, aggression, injustice, wrongdoing. One of it is jealousy, out of jealousy, obstinacy, inad, ta'assub, bigotry. Bigotry. I've heard many people say, I would not accept Islam because Islam is the religion of Arabs. Why didn't God send Quran in English? Why didn't he send Prophet Muhammad to Chicago here? At that time we had the, you know, America, although we did not have Chicago, but we had a continent, America. Why didn't he send him to Germany? Why didn't he send him to Mecca? I'm not going to accept him. Not because Muhammad is wrong. Not because this book does not make sense. No, it makes sense and Muhammad is not wrong, but because God chose Muhammad an Arab, not from a different nation. This is bigotry. Now, whether Muhammad is an Arab or Indian or Chinese, what difference it makes? You get the message from وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ. He's the messenger of God. You have to accept the message of God. So it's a test. It's a test. Actually, if you read the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Rasulullah, do you know this, the community of Arabs who are around you, Quraysh? وَلَوْ نَزَّلْنَاهُ عَلَىٰ بَعْضِ الْأَعْجَمِينَ فَقَرَأَهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مَا كَانُوا بِهِ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Had we sent this book in another language, not the Arabic language, and the Prophet comes to Quraysh, the Arabs, and tells them, listen, I have the revelation of God, but it's not Arabic, it's Persian, it's Urdu. The Arabs wouldn't have accepted him. Allah says in the book, Allah is chastising and criticizing the Arabs, the Quraysh. He says, if that book was in non-Arab, the Arabs, مَا كَانُوا بِهِ مُؤْمِنِينَ. They would reject the book out of bigotry and ta'assub. So this bigotry does exist in every community, in the Arabs and the non-Arabs. Ta'assub. Why he's not one of me? If he's one of me, same, you know, skin color, same, you know, tribe, same language, I would follow him. If not, I would reject him. He's an alien. I would reject him. This is bigotry. So Allah says, those who rejected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they rejected him out of understanding and knowledge, and they received the bayinat. Received the bayinat. وَجَاءَهُمُ الْبَيِّنَاتِ. They knew very clearly, with no doubt, that he is an authentic messenger of God. But they rejected him بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ. Out of hatred, jealousy, bigotry. They did not want the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And many people, they said this right in his face. They said to him, we don't accept you because you are not from my tribe. You are an Arab, but because you are not from the branch of Arabia, which is my tribe, I would not follow you. Out of bigotry. Therefore, ilm sometimes, knowledge brings ghurur and conceit and arrogance more than the money. You know the danger of ilm sometimes supersedes the danger of wealth and money. This is why the alim, when he becomes munharif, deviates, he becomes more dangerous than the president, than the commander of the army, because he's going to mislead the nation. As we see now, some of the ulama who have no taqwa, who have no piety, who do not work for Allah, they work for the shaitan. We do have many of them in the Middle East, mashallah. We have an abundance. we are exporting to these countries and those countries. Some of them, they leave their home countries and they go to Gulf states, they give them citizenship. It becomes citizenship of Qatar and this country and that country, and he starts issuing fatwa. Not to satisfy Allah, to satisfy the emir, the king, the political leader who is working for him, because he's giving him a salary. Ulama al-Su, we have them. The Quran mentions the story of one of them. So they are aplenty. Ilm, if you separate between ilm and piety, that ilm becomes very dangerous. That ilm becomes a tool to destroy the societies, not to build them. To divide the people, not to unite them. Ilm is a very dangerous tool. If someone misuses ilm, the scholar, the alim, he misuses his ilm and his wisdom, he's going to destroy the whole societies. And this is exactly what we see nowadays within the Muslim Ummah. These killings that are happening nowadays, you know, they have been endorsed by some mufti, some alim. He says, yes, it's good, kill this group. They deserve death. Their women, their children, their temples, their mosques, their centers, their marketplaces, their cities should be destroyed. And that person is alim, he's not jahil, he's not ignorant. And he could memorize the whole Quran from cover to cover. He memorized it by heart. But yet, his ilm is empty. There is no wara', there is no piety, there is no God-fearing with his ilm. This is what we see nowadays. Al-ilm, ruwiya an Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, annahu qal, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, العلم هو الحجاب الأكبر. Sometimes ilm, which has no piety and discipline with it, he does not see God with it, becomes the biggest veil that separates the individual from his Lord. The ilm, not ignorance, not jahl, ilm itself becomes very dangerous. الحجاب الأكبر, hijab, a veil that separates the servant from his Lord. حجاب الأكبر. And the example of that we see nowadays. We see with many muftis, many scholars who can easily issue a fatwa to slaughter people, to slaughter them. And those people, they have no sanctity, no value. I don't know how they're going to stand before God tomorrow. What would they say to God? On what basis they killed, they gave their blessing and their fatwa, and they stir hatred. Hatred among the Muslims. The alim should bring the hearts together. Allah said to Musa, Musa, I did not send you to disconnect. I sent you to the people to connect them with me. للوصل, لا للفصل. I did not send you to separate them from me, to keep them away. I want you to bring the hearts. Market my case to the people. When you go, speak, tell the people about my mercy, about my forgiveness. Be positive, don't be negative. Today, some of the ulama, the only thing they speak about is Jahannam, 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 Nar, punishment, this, that, that. I see them sometimes on television. They ask them on the air, on television, some of the Arab countries. This scholar, he's the part of this Supreme Council, Majlis al-A'la of ulama and fuqaha, a lady asks him a simple question. He becomes so angry. He loses control. He loses his control. He starts yelling at her, yelling at her. People run away from God. Believe me, yesterday I saw an interview in Syria, in the city of Aleppo, Halab in Syria, of a family who lost their son. They lost their young son to this group, ISIS, the terrorist groups. They said, the mother said, they killed my son while they were screaming, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. So now anytime I hear this statement, Allahu Akbar, I am terrified, I am terrified. I can't stand here, Allahu Akbar. Anytime I hear, Allahu Akbar is the most beautiful statement, the most beautiful. Imagine what they did to this mother. beleaguered mother, when she lost her son. Do you blame her? Do you blame people when they run away from religion? Do you blame them? أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونسبحه ونقدسه على آلائه ونعمائه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وترحم على محمد وآل محمد كأفضل ما صليت وسلمت وباركت وترحمت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. وصل اللهم وسلم على خلفاء نبيك وأوصيائه وأهل بيته وأحبته علي أمير المؤمنين وقائد الغر المحجلين وعلى البضعة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين وعلى سبطي نبي الرحمة وسيدي شباب أهل الجنة الحسن والحسين عليهما السلام وعلى علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الهادي المهدي أجل الله تعالى فرجه وسهل مخرجه وجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه. عباد الله أوصيكم وأوصي نفسي بتقوى الله ولزوم أمره. قال تعالى في كتابه الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولا تكونوا كالذين تفرقوا واختلفوا من بعد ما جاءهم البينات وأولئك لهم عذاب عظيم. صدق الله العلي العظيم. Many people who are following the sad news that are coming out of Iraq and Syria and Lebanon and Yemen and many other countries, Muslim countries, they ask, what is our responsibility? What should we do as Muslims living in the West? I know when ISIS, they invaded and occupied many Iraqi cities recently, some people came to me and they said, can we carry the weapon and go there? I said to them that we have another mission here in America, more important than carrying this weapon. There are, mashallah, people, you know, the only thing that Muslims have surplus in are human, mashallah. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. We are not short on human resources. We have many people. So there are many volunteers who are ready to defend their cities and their countries and their lands. We can do something more important in America, in our home here. Our responsibility is to bring the hearts together. These divided hearts, this division between the Shia and the Sunni, we can heal it. We can bridge this gap. We can do that here. Maybe we have no control over Syria or Lebanon or Iraq or Afghanistan or Pakistan or Yemen or Egypt or Saudi Arabia. But we have some influence here in our backyard here. We have to fix our backyard. We can do that in our own capacity as Muslims, worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, devout Muslims. We can do some good, some healing. By calling on both sides to get together, to respect each other despite the differences. I've said this sentence many times. We have differences. Some of these differences are fundamental. Some people think when we speak about unity, it means that the Shia should pray the Sunni way and the Sunni should pray the Shia way. No, this is not the way. We have differences, we acknowledge them. But it's a challenge when you have a difference with someone, you have a big challenge. You cannot get close to him. You have to destroy this barrier. You have to try to reach out to others. A brave person, a successful person is the one that despite his differences with others, he has the ability, the courage of reaching out to others and breaking these barriers. It's not easy, it's hard, but it is doable. We can do that. Sometimes I've heard some Shias, very few though, very, very, very few, who curse the Sahaba of the Prophet. This should stop. None of our Imams, my friends, if you read the entire biography and the life of our Imams, from Imam Ali till Imam al-Mahdi, you would never come across a place where the Imam cursed one of the Sahaba. They disagreed with them, but they did not curse them. Cursing is used by someone who is empty. He does not have logical argument. He's defeated. Then he resorts to cursing, profanity, sab. But if you have a logical argument, you would use it. You would not use profanity against anyone. You would not bad mouth them. Allah says in this book, O Muslims, O Sahaba of the Prophet, وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. When you meet with the polytheist, with the mushrikeen, do not use profanity against their idols. Once you swear against their idols, they're going to swear back against whom? Against Allah, your Lord. Do you want your Lord to be sworn at? You don't want this to happen. Don't do that. So we have some few Shia. They call themselves Shia and they think they are doing the right thing. And they were able to brainwash small number of the people. We have to be wise. When you have a logical, scientific argument, you don't have to use a profanity. Say, be polite, be firm, but polite. This is the argument of the Quran. Amir al-Mu'mineen, our beloved leader and imam, after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, "Inni akrahu lakum an takunu sabbabin." If you want to follow me, to be my follower, I hate for you to use a profanity. Don't be sabbab. Sabbab, the one who always bad mouths other. If you want to be in the group of Imam Ali, in his group, don't use this method. Stop using it. On the other hand, we have within the Sunni community, who do not recognize Shias as being Muslims. I've seen them, sometimes they come to the masjid, he sits here Friday, as soon as he finds out that this is Allah, Muhammad, Ali, Fatima, he runs away. Believe me, he would not run away from a synagogue, from a Hindu temple, the way he runs from a Shia masjid. What happened? Why? What will happen? Come and see what we are doing here. See the way we worship, and then judge. But because of misconceptions, he learned that from his mother, his father, his friend, rumors. They survive on rumors, not on ilm and bayinat. Allah says, be careful of what you hear. So you do not accuse others wrongly. إِن جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَأٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا أَن تُصِيبُوا قَوْمًا بِجَهَالَةٍ. When someone tells you the Shia are this and that, say, stop, let me go and find out myself. You have a Shia friend, go to his house. There is a Shia masjid, go to his house. Before you start judging, before you run away from here. The other day we almost had a stampede here, you know. Although we welcome, we embrace. Some of the radical Sunnis, they use takfir against the Shia. If you are a Shia, then you are kafir immediately. I can't eat with you, we cannot marry from you, we cannot live with you, we cannot talk to you, are worse than Jews and Christians. This is what they say. Shias are Jews, worse than Jews and Christians. This has to stop. Do you agree with me or you disagree?
Yes.
Have you seen these or you haven't? I am the only one who sees them. These things have to stop. Here in America, we have no control over Saudi Arabia. Let Saudi Arabia enjoy democracy and freedom. They will go, inshallah, all to paradise, inshallah. At least here, the Muslims here, let's get together, respect each other, work together, reach out to each other. We respect each other's traditions. Neither we use bad language, bad approach, suspicion against the Sunnis. Neither they disrespect us and they consider us to be kafir. Both have to stop, and we can do that. Begins with me, you, all the sisters, all the young, all the adults. We can do that. We can protect our societies. I don't want kids like this golden boy who's sitting here, Habibi. This is sweetheart. I don't want him to live in a community where he sees hypocrisy. Muslims are disrespecting each other. I don't want him to see this. We always call for intra-faith. Let's have good relationship with the Christians, with Jews. How about the Muslims? What about intra-faith? Are we taking care of intra-faith? Believe me, we did so much of interfaith, so much of interfaith activities. How about intra-faith among Islam? Did we do enough? Did we do to hold ourselves together? This is our call, and this is our responsibility, my friends. I urge you as a humble brother of you and servant of you, if you have a Sunni family, Sunni friend, be good to them. Tell them we separate between what ISIS and the radicals and the extremists and the terrorists do and between you. We separate. We separate. We distinguish. We have a brain. We distinguish. We distinguish between who's who, the good and the bad. We do that. Reach out to them. The month of Ramadan is coming. A beautiful opportunity for love, to enhance love and respect and harmony and peace. The month of Quran, the month of forgiveness. Let's invite them to our homes, to our masajid. Come with me, break the fast with me. Come and look at my program. Listen to my Quran. See if you can find another copy of Quran hidden somewhere here in the drawer. Bring it, let me see it. What Quran is that? Tell them. And the month of Ramadan is coming, my friends. I want you to intensify your effort. The heart is empty. When the heart is empty, the soul is empty, the man becomes dangerous. The man is going to do all sorts of violations and crimes if the heart is empty. You have to fill it during the month of Quran, the month of istighfar, the month where we get closer to Allah. We focus less on the dunya and more on the akhir, on our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I urge you to come to the masjid. The program is going to begin on Sunday, which is June 29th. And those of you who have not received this calendar last week, last Friday, Ay Haydari, I want you please to bring some. So we give it to the mu'mineen this Friday, inshallah, because we did not send it by mail and we corrected it. So if you don't have it, get a copy of this. Every night, inshallah, we're going to have a program that begins 1 hour before the Adhan, with a Quranic circle here, recitation of Quran and learning of the Quran, and then the Salat, the Iftar, Dua al-Iftitah, and then the Quranic Tafsir for 30 to 35 minutes. And also we need you to donate for the Iftar. We are short of money, believe me, for the Iftar. We don't want to stop Iftar. We've been giving Iftar for the last 10 years for the entire month of Ramadan. This year the board were debating whether we give one night or two nights because of the budget. I said to them, no, inshallah, our mu'mineen are good and excellent. They did not disappoint us in the past and they would not disappoint us this season. So if each one can donate for one night or half a night, maybe two or three people, they donate for one night of iftar, inshallah ta'ala. And today we started the youth camp. I will join them there. Our youth, they left already. Those of you who would like to join us, you can come after the Salat, inshallah, or tomorrow, Saturday, we have a good pool of speakers for this camp, inshallah. And the next Friday, I am going to see you, inshallah, after 6 weeks. I am heading to Karbala, Iraq. inshallah, to be there. My father needs me to be with him. And my father is everything for me in this life. He's my teacher, my mentor, my everything. Spiritual father, you know, biological father. And he needs, at the age of 86, he's doing a lot of work in Iraq. The hospital, the orphanage, the lectures, he needs me to be next to him. So, inshallah, I'm going to pray for you under the dome of Imam Hussein alayhi salam in Karbala for the entire month of Ramadan, and I will see you after Eid al-Fitr al-Mubarak, inshallah. Allahumma aghfir lil-mu'minina wal-mu'minat wal-muslimina wal-muslimat al-ahya'i minhum wal-amwat tabi' allahumma baynana wa baynahum bil-khayrat اللهم وحد كلمة المسلمين على الخير والصلاح والبر والتقوى يا أرحم الراحمين من على مرضانا بالشفاء والعافية فك أسرانا وسجناءنا وعجل في فرج سيدنا ومولانا صاحب العصر والزمان وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات والشهداء ثواب الفاتحة مع الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد